Unser Land braucht Menschen, die an sich glauben. Erste Bank und Sparkasse.
number of proteins that we will have to produce that are based on animals. And that is out of two reasons. So one is that a lot of people in the world start eating more and more meat in developing countries. And the second reason is that we need animal protein to feed other animals. And that's actually a really big problem, because in the European Union, for example, we produce actually only 26% of the proteins that we currently need to feed the most efficient livestock, the most efficient animals, which are fish and poultry. This is jumps ahead a little bit. Okay, I'm actually not doing this myself right now. Okay, I think I'm now back in charge. So insects offer a real opportunity to tackle this problem. We need way less space to feed and grow them. We need way less feed in order to feed them. We need a fraction of the water it takes to grow beef, for example, and only a fraction of the CO2 emissions that it really takes to produce the common types of livestock that we know today. They are really competitive in their functionality. So the reason why animal proteins are still more efficient than plant proteins in many ways is because they're very close to our body proteins or other animal proteins. So that's why when animals or we ourselves eat animal protein, we usually tend to digest it easier, so our bodies can really deal with it in an easier way. And that's the case for insect proteins. So we have a really good fatty acid profile, which is very close to olive oil, and 100% of the animal can be used. So nothing is really thrown away when we or animals eat insects. The droppings of the insects can be used as a fertilizer, and as already mentioned, they're also more efficient in terms of space than soy, for example, more efficient in their water use, as well as more CO2 efficient. So we can really close the loop here when using food waste to feed insects and grow them as a protein source. We've started out a couple of years back in Hong Kong. So we have two offices right now. One is in Hong Kong and one is in Vienna. We founded the company in 2015 in Hong Kong, and the last couple of years we've been around a lot in the B2C space. So we built these mini insect farms that you can see here on the slide to empower people to grow proteins on their desktops, on their countertops. This was sold into more than 48 countries worldwide. And to a lot of schools, universities. What we saw after the launch of our first product, which we launched on Kickstarter, and then we spent a lot of time in Shenzhen, China, to manufacture it ourselves, we saw that actually a lot of our customers were less interested in producing a lot of mealworms to eat themselves, but actually they were really interested in the educational aspect of it, in sharing it with their families and their communities. And that's why we launched our second product, which we called Hive Explorer. And it's specifically for the utilization in schools and for educational purposes. Here you see just a really short glimpse into the product development. So it went through a couple of different stages. The very first one was with a different kind of insect, and then we actually went to Africa and we multiplicated this project in several continents: Africa, Asia, the United States, in Hawaii, and so on, until it became what it is today. It went through to customers globally, here in China, actually, in the US, I believe, in the UK, and people did very interesting things with it. They recoded it. They obviously cooked with it and shared shared it really lively in our communities. And that's actually our educational unit. So we utilize our mini insect farms in order to make the topic of sustainability more prevalent in schools. So you can imagine this as a science kit. So you might know these little ancient age Tritops, things that you can buy as eggs, and then you put them in water and they swim around. Maybe you can compare it a little bit to that, just that you can actually use your food waste that you have at home and feed it to the insects, harvest the fertilizer to put into your plants again. And it comes with a lot of educational material that will teach kids specifically, but also the grown-ups about the world of insects, what they do to benefit our environment, how we can use them to make the world more sustainable, to feed animals and humans, and to upcycle and recycle waste. So we've done this in quite a huge way in Asia, in schools all over Hong Kong, and the product is actually right now being manufactured, and we will ship next month, which was actually quite a big journey to go from the first product to the second one. We anticipated it to be a little bit smoother, but it still takes a lot of time to even do just a very small changes in the product to make it make it go the next level up. And what we're working on since last year is the scale up of our technology. So we patented our technology. It's about really providing the most efficient way of growing insect proteins on the smallest footprint possible. And we have made the next step to really make this to implement this on a large scale and do this in an industrial way. So on the one hand, we manufacture small units for education to make people more aware of sustainability matters and recycle and upcycle in their own homes. And on the other hand, we do this on an industrial level. And with that, we're producers of proteins and fertilizers that is sold B2B to companies that then make products out of it. So at the moment, we have a pilot project with Europe's largest retailer, and they have a huge amount of bakery waste specifically that they currently mostly goes to waste. So we take that bakery waste, we feed it to our insects, we take our technology for it, and then the outcome is our ingredient, the alternative proteins, as well as fertilizer. So the fertilizer goes back to grow grain and actually produce food again for people, while the protein ingredients, feeding pets even, fertilizer for plants, and also into sports nutrition or other nutritional products for people. So that's how we close the loop. We've gone through multiple milestones for this, and we're now scaling up, and that is happening in Vienna. So we're really doing this with urban protein farms, which we're pretty excited about. So if you look at the impact that we have, we compare different factors to it. So we have CO2 emissions that we're saving. We have land that we're saving because we can go vertical and we save a lot of feed that we would otherwise use to grow crops for livestock. If we use the ingredient to feed fish, for example, or feed poultry even in the future, then this saves a lot of fish meal that is currently sourced from the ocean. So we save in our five-year business plan at the moment, we're saving about 70,000 tons of ocean fish when replacing the fish meal that we can produce with insect proteins, or the insect meal, replace it with the amount of insect meal that we are planning to produce. we would fulfill the protein need of half of Brussels population for 1 year if you compare it to Brussels. We're saving the arable land as big as Brussels as a city, and we would take all cars in Brussels off the road for 1 year in terms of CO2 emissions. All right, I think that's pretty much it from my end. I hope this gave you a little bit of an overview, and I'm looking forward to hearing your questions.
All right, thank you so much for your talk, Katarina. We have a few questions from the audience right now. So for example, what do you see the future of living farms? Where do you see living farms in the future, and what do you want to do?
Right. So I see living farms as our goal is to become one of the largest producers of technology and protein itself. So I do see us grow in these two ways that I mentioned in education. So really making sure that people are aware of the benefits of upcycling food waste into higher value products and producing this on a larger scale in order to close the loop in a way that has a large impact on communities and on countries.
Thank you. And the second question we have is, how did you actually come up with the idea of using insects?
That's a long story. it started with me going to Hong Kong. My background is industrial design. So I started out going to Hong Kong and China as an industrial designer, wanting to make products. And then at some point I realized that I didn't really want to use my time so much to, design the next headphones that are going to be disposed of very soon, or the next car interior. But I really wanted to use it to make the world better and have a real positive impact on our future. And that's what I was inspired to do when I visited Hong Kong and I saw the density of the place, and that there's very little space to grow things, and that we need new solutions for that.
Okay, thank you. And one more final question is, how do you see financing of the next farm in Austria? How do you plan to finance your next farm?
Right now, luckily, we are financed. So we have funding in place at the moment to do our next phase. But of course, we already have it in our plan to go into fundraising again. And we seek to finance that out of revenues that we will already make. But of course, that is not going to be enough for a real big scale up. So then we're going to look into venture capital and other forms of investment from outside.
Thank you so much for your time, your speech and your answers. Thank you so much. And afterwards, we're continuing with Stefan Pan. So thank you so much, Katarina.
Great.
For being part of Avenue.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
And I'm really looking forward to present you today the sweet spot between ecology and economy. I'm just taking a look at the colleagues here. If everything is right, give me a thumb up. Everybody can hear me. Thumb up. Nice. So I will start with our storyline. I started about 10 years ago by developing the first Sunnybag solar backpack. Since then, we have sold more than 120,000 units. And if you use, for example, it for only 1.5 hours per day, it generates more than 394 megawatt hours per year of solar energy, of green energy. And if you put this energy, for example, because it's a lot of energy, almost 400 megawatt hours, if you put this energy, tank it into a Tesla Model 3, so you charge this car, you can go from Earth to Moon 7 times. So it's a lot of green energy we produce globally with our solar charging backpacks, with our Sunnybag products. Our vision is very clear. We want to become the genre-defining brand worldwide. No matter if you're here in the streets of Las Vegas, like our country manager Colby here with the Sunnybag Iconic, if you're far away from a plaque on the beach with the Explorer Plus backpack, or with our Sunnybag Iconic here in our beautiful hometown, Graz. Very important if you develop products is that you focus on lead user groups. We do it with different partners, for example, in Africa with Doctors Without Borders or with Austrian Development Agency. And these lead users test your product in within areas where you have a lot of humidity, where you have a lot of heat, where you have extreme conditions. And this helps you to improve your products. Also, I want to point out that there's a lot of local support possibilities here in Graz, for example, like the Science Park Graz. And there are a lot of subsidies or Förderstellen, as we say in Austria, like in Austria, the FFG and the AWS, Austria Wirtschaft Service, and in Steiermark, in Styria specifically, the Steirische Wirtschaftsförderung, the Styrian subsidy for economy. If you start your idea, your product, your innovation, your startup, think about press. We made some nice press pictures 10 years ago almost. So this picture was, this was my hairstyle, my Corona hairstyle 10 years ago. And this led to a lot of articles in press, which is very important that people know you, that they know that your product, that they look up on your website, that they contact you. Join awards. Awards is very important as well. Like here on the right side, we won some nice awards in Germany and Austria, etc. Maybe join some shows, some TV shows, like we did it with 2 Million 2 Minutes or 2 Minutes 2 Million. Or Die Höhle der Löwen in Germany. And as you see here on the bottom line, this graph shows you the peak we had after the show. So you get a lot of revenue, you get a lot of contacts, and it's very important that the deal is that you get a deal in the show, because they will cut it positive and it will be aired live if you have a deal, because it's all about the deal in the end of the day in these shows. Here a little bit about our e-commerce. So we have our platforms like Shopify and Amazon Prime. We do the invoicing over an app called Quaderno, and we do the shipment and the fulfillment over an app called Orderdesk. And my tip here is let the bots do the work for you. So if you have a process that is doing the same job every day, don't have somebody doing the job, some from your team. Think about a bot who could do this completely automatically. And if we make like 5,000 euros per day, everything gets automated with this automation. And we can also do, 50K per day easily without having any employer doing anything at all. Think about marketing and conversion tracking. So here we have I joined this live sales TV thing. Wasn't not the best idea for me at the beginning, but it was very interesting because they stream this live and they see how many order phone calls will be in your pitch, in your presentation, when you do the 15-minute presentation. And based on that, they decide what has a high conversion, what story that you told. This was here, for example, the peak I had when I showed the product and how the product specifically works and what are the specs of the product. And then you repeat this high converting information. And this is the rest of the 45 minutes when some 1 hour, you know, presentation goes live on TV. So I learned a lot here. And this is actually the same you do today when you try to sell a product online. You test different ads. You spread very, very thin, basically, in all different areas. You know, shoot in all directions and see what you fit. And after, and it's very important that you track the conversion, that you see how many orders you will get specifically on the ad, and then you pick and choose the right ad and boost it with some additional budget. Some tricks here and some links that might be interesting is check the Facebook library, where you can search for ads of your competitors. And here on the right hand, some ideas how an ad has to be in 2020. So you start with a social proof, you get down to the content, you get down with one sentence to the ownership benefit. You have to use videos or pictures in you know, square shaped. And underneath, again, we give a guarantee, we give a social proof, and once again, the ownership benefit. So this is what we do if we post something on social media in 2020. And how to sell hardware products in 2020? I highly recommend to think about Amazon FBA, fulfillment by Amazon. So shipping and selling over Amazon. There are a lot of platforms that you can use in order to boost your sales. I highly recommend, or we highly recommend, Helium 10, that shows behind the, or that enables you to look behind the curtain. So you can see how much sales and how much revenue your competitors do. And I also highly recommend to be a partner to your partners. So here we have partners in China, of course, they support us in the production for the battery packs. We invite them here, like in Salzburg, go out for a meeting, for after the meeting for a nice dinner, show them around about around Salzburg, also with a tourist guide who speaks Chinese. And this is very important that you really build up relationships, same relationships you want to have as well. And on the right hand, we also do a lot of selfies on our booths. Course of Corona, there are not that many shows at the moment, but if we are at CES in Las Vegas, if we are at IFA in Berlin, we do a lot of selfies, and it gets higher conversions if you contact somebody who has been on your booth and gave you a business card when you send him an email, a follow-up email with a picture on it. So I highly recommend to do this as well. Last but not least, because I got only 10 minutes, some personal development tips or tricks. Let's start on the right, on the left side. The serotonin level is always in the morning on the highest point. So try to make meetings that are important before lunchtime in the morning, between, you know, 8 and 12, something like this. Because by time, serotonin gets down. And if you have a meeting like now, it's 5 p.m. here in Graz, in Vienna. Nobody cares that much, and it's always important if you want to succeed, if you want to achieve something, make the meetings in the morning. Everybody really wants to reach a goal if the meeting is in a morning session. Do sports, watch some TED presentations. I always like to listen to Blinkist. So these are some short 10 to 15 minutes reviews, or not reviews, some summaries of books, for example. Really high recommend this. And also try to go very vertical into a topic like we do it here with Amazon, for example, on podcasts and maybe also YouTube. So these are some tips and tricks from my side. So I hope it was not boring at all. was just 10 minutes, and I look really forward to your question. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stefan, for your talk, for a very, very interesting talk. We have a few questions from the viewers. The first one, do you use responsibly sourced materials for your bags?
Responsibly sourced materials for the bags? Yes, I mean, we have some criteria. For example, the packaging boxes need to be out of recycled paper. We avoid plastic completely on the packaging boxes. It goes beyond that. We ship, for example, also CO2 neutral since last year.
Great, thanks. The next question is, do you actually produce in Austria?
No, we don't. We do not produce in Austria at the moment. We have a partner in Tirol who is in the development or is building up a very large scale production of a thin film panel, of a solar panel that is produced in Tirol, in nearby Wörgl or nearby Innsbruck. But it's not ready yet. The production is not ready yet. But as soon as it's ready, we will produce in Austria as well. At the moment, it is not possible, but we are working on it.
Perfect. Thank you. And one more question from the audience. Have you tried using influencers on social media for social media marketing?
Yes, we did. We did tested influencers on Instagram, also on Facebook, and also on YouTube. And the best conversions we get at the moment is on YouTube. So our tip or trick here is contact, search first on YouTube, some YouTubers who tested similar products than yours, contact them. There is the information field. If you go directly on their channel, mostly they have also an email address behind it, or you can type in a short message, contact them, offer them a sample for free. And they get it, they test it, and they normally put an affiliate link, an Amazon affiliate link underneath, and this drives your conversions. So if you go with influencers, I highly recommend today to use YouTubers who do reviews and, you know, these unboxing videos.
Perfect. Thank you so much for your presentation and all of your answers. It was really, really great. Right now, we're going to ask everybody to go either to the socializing tab and talk to our partners and startups or explore other stages. And we'll be right back on the sustainability stage with the panel on sustainable food. Thank you so much, Stefan. We'll be right back.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
4 Gigabandbreite und Zero Latenz? Dann gleich loszocken im 5-Giganetz von A1, dem Internet der Gamer. Du kannst alles im 5-Giganetz von A1.
Now I have to jump in at this point because we've just gone live, I've been told. So obviously you can just see we're already warming up here, and we're at our panel. Yes, we're at our panel, and we're going to be talking about sustainable food for the future. Obviously this is exactly the topic we're going to sort out within the next half an hour. We're going to fight world hunger, so no pressure on us. However, let's find out who we have on our stage, and I'd like to start with you, Meng. Maybe you can tell us who you are and what you do.
Yeah, sure. So my name is Meng, and I grew up in the city in China. It's called Chengdu. So the city has 16 million population. So, you know, small city, just twice as many people as in Austria. And I moved to United States in 2011 for my PhD degree in food science. And I graduated with a PhD in food science from University of Maryland in 2014. And then I worked in the US Food and Drug Administration in the analytical chemistry department for a little bit under 2 years. And then I just, I joined a company in San Francisco called Just. I joined this company in 2016 as a food scientist, and now I'm leading the food science team at Just. So pretty much I'm doing the technical part of the product development and Eat Just. And we are a company founded around 2011, and one of our first product is this Just Mayo. So it's a mayonnaise, but it's completely plant-based and that doesn't have any eggs. So no issue with egg allergy, also sustainable, very good sustainability. And so it just, we have raised more than 220 million as of 2016. And in the following 4 years, we've raised an undisclosed amount. And so in 2013, we were named as three companies for the future of the food by Bill Gates. And our early stage investors, including Salesforce, Mark Benioff, and also Asian's businessman, richest businessman, Li Ka-shing. And right now, our company's flagship products are Just Egg. So this one is like a plant-based liquid egg format. So you can kind of just open it and shake it, open it, and then scramble it into any egg dish, just like what you would do with a liquid egg. And we just launched a new product. I'm sorry, this looks like a TV commercial.
It's actually quite a long introduction.
But I was told that the people
I'll
like
to see
I'll
give you one more product, and then we'll have to go to the next one.
Okay, so we have this sure. Just
I'm
Egg.
I'm going
to buy it. We just launched this Just Egg. So it's a plant-based egg, and it comes with those kind of frozen pockets. So you pop it into the toaster oven, and it comes ready as egg patty. You can put it in your sandwich. Okay, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Philip.
All right, so keeping the style of the TV commercial, just by coincidence, I have a little package of our product here on the side as well. So I'm Philip, and I'm one of the co-founders of Rebel Meat. And what we do is we have created burger patties that only need 50% of meat to give you the full meat experience. And why do we do that? Because we're on a mission to make meat more sustainable. And we think more sustainable means less and better. So we know that many people out there try to eat less meat because, obviously people know that a lot of meat consumption is responsible for rainforest destruction, climate change, a lot of also animal-related problems, etc. But putting that into practice is actually quite hard. And that's why the rate of vegans and vegetarians are not really increasing, and the amount of meat in the Western world is pretty much stagnant, and in the developing world it's actually growing quite fast. So we said, okay, let's have a perfect combination here of you can still enjoy your meat, but it's less and it gives you the full experience, and it's much better because it's organic, it's not with imported soy. It's without any artificial flavors or anything like this. We're based in Vienna, and we actually were on the show 2 Minutes, 2 Million last week. And since then, we're also available in the supermarkets. So if you haven't tried us, check us out. And with that, I'm going to end my TV commercial.
Thank you very much. That was also an amazing pitch. It was a good introduction. No pressure on you, Katy, but go for it.
Yeah, going last. So I'm Katerina. I'm founder of Live In Farms, which you see here, but I heard that it's kind of the other way around. Sorry for that. So by chance, I actually also have a product here. kind of an older version of it. In some cases, we called it microfoods. Now, probably you see this the other way around as well. But in any case, we grow mealworms. So we grow insects as an alternative protein source, as well as fertilizer. And we focus on the technological aspect of it. So we are working on technology to grow these alternative proteins in the most efficient way, both from a sustainability perspective and a circular economy perspective. So insects as compared to plant-based protein or other livestock protein have a complete amino acid profile. They have a very good fatty acid profile. So they're very high quality and very well digestible by both humans and animals. And they can eat food waste. So bakery waste, that's the key source that we're working with right now. They're really good in eating that up as compared to, you know, pigs or poultry or cattle. And they can turn it really efficiently with very minimal resources and minimal space into high quality products. So that's proteins, oils, fats, and fertilizer. So the poop you can, of course, also use.
Now here goes my challenge. Obviously, I have a bit of a challenge on this panel because I totally love all three products. I love the idea and I'm all for it. However, if I'm the host now, I'll have to kind of take my own bias out. So here goes. That was kind of my excuse. So I'll try it this way. Now, obviously, listening to all of you, it seems like a no-brainer that there should be mass market adoption because all three are a lot better than the current things. However, why is there no mass market adoption yet? Or is there?
I can start because I think our product as compared to the other two projects here is not only B2C. So we're doing B2B business, I don't mean it in terms of that you wouldn't do B2B business as such. I just meant it's not necessarily consumer facing only as the end product. So we actually don't sell directly to the consumer, but it's an ingredient for both food and feed. So the challenge that we're looking at as one of the segments of this larger challenge of sustainability in the food market, I think, is that people are continuing to eat meat to some extent. So we see that by 2030, we'll have a doubling of the demand in animal proteins worldwide. That is that countries on the verge of industrialization or that are going or ramping up industrialization right now, they are eating more meat because they become wealthier. And even in Europe, we see an increase of 60% of demand in animal protein by 2030. So the demand in animal proteins is not stopping anytime too soon. And that is also because animals have an easier way digesting animal proteins as compared to plant-based proteins. So, for example, fish is being fed with fish meal, which is totally unsustainable because it's sourced from ocean fish. But that's what makes fish grow the fastest and the best because it can digest it perfectly fine. But with our solution, we can feed fish equally well or even better, but much more sustainably without using fish from the ocean and with actually using food waste that is already available and underutilized.
Why is the old approach broken? Why is had meat? Everything sufficient. Why is this becoming a challenge? Just kind of for people who are new to this topic.
So for us, it's
whoever
because,
wants to jump in.
Sorry, just quickly. So on the feed section, it is because the old system was built on sort of a premise of abundant resources, abundant fish in the ocean, for example, and that's not working anymore.
And obviously more population coming along as well. And with that, the challenge of feeding more and more people who have more and more access, that becomes quite a challenge. So we can kind of agree on that. This is not just a question of the distant future. This is actually, right? Now my approach is, obviously, if we look at adoption curves of innovation, I'd be curious. Obviously, we have a lot of business students listening, and so they all know what the famous Ford T model is. You know, the first car that made it to mass adoption. How far are we to the T model? Do we already have a T model in let's say alternative meats and proteins, whatnot? Or are we still far away?
So I think I can speak of that. I think to answer your first question, our company has been around for 8-9 years. At this point, I would say we have successfully reached mass production. As of today, we've sold 14 million equivalent of eggs, and we have purchased our own protein production facility for plant-based protein, the protein that we identified by ourselves, mung bean protein. And also we have, I think one thing that I saw is changing is how traditional industry is adapting to this new change we are trying to make. And one thing really helped Just grow is that we tapped into the existing infrastructure of the traditional industry. So we are creating a new category of product, and there is definitely innovation in there. But we are not gonna rebuild the entire food system by ourselves, right? We are still relying on the ecosystem the traditional industry has already built. So just at it, just we have already signed three big egg manufacturers. So those are chicken egg manufacturers as our business partners. One is Irovo Group based in Italy, and PHW Group based in Germany, and Micro Foods based in United States. And those are all international egg manufacturers. And now they are opening up to a new idea saying, hey, we want to be partner with you. We want to make this vegan egg as well. So they used to think us as competitors. You know, they want to, they see us taking away their profit, but now they see a new opening market that they also want to be part of it. And I think we are also very open for partnership. That's how we got to a point where we have achieved mass production and the most impact.
Thank you. I'd just like to jump in here quite quickly. Two questions. Number one, if you're listening and have questions, you can post them on Slido. And we have the first Slido question, which I'd just like to jump in. And that's at Katarina. What are insects eating? That's kind of the question there. So what do they eat?
What do they eat?
Yes.
Yeah, so they can eat very low quality stuff. So right now in our production, they mainly eat bakery waste. So the bakery, the rolls and the bread that are left over in the shops, in the retailers at night, we dry that and crush it. And we mix it with some other secret ingredients, but mostly they eat that.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, obviously, I'd like to also kind of take this discussion because obviously we're seeing there's a lot of revolution going on, a lot of change needing to happen in this. Sometimes listening into these lines, one would think like the future is vegan or vegan. Now, Philip, obviously, I'd have to ask you this. What's your take on that?
So our take is that there are very good vegan options around and have been actually for a couple of years. Now, there are some problems with some of the existing products, especially when it comes to artificial ingredients and so on. But I think what is even more important than product is probably a customer acceptance. And it just turns out that for a quite big fraction of the population, meat is just culturally very deeply ingrained. And, you know, it's part of many traditions. It's everywhere readily and very cheap available. And whether that's good or not, it's just a fact. And it's not going to go away anytime soon. And so there's different approaches to this, right? So there, on the one hand, you have the whole cell-based meat industry where companies are trying to grow actual animal-based DNA in a bioreactor. You have the whole plant-based movement where you try to mimic meat from plant-based materials. And we're kind of in the middle, right? We're saying, so we're reducing meat and making sure we're only using really the very best available. So that's on the one hand has a short-term impact rather than some of the long-term gains, and giving people that want to reduce now but not completely give up on it, or maybe not even on a single meal and give up on it, a chance to reduce right now. And in the long term, actually, and we believe that we can be the key enabler for the whole cell-based movement. Because imagine if you have a bioreactor where you grow cells, they will probably not come out in a form that is directly eatable for the end consumer. So most likely you will have to blend it with some kind of plant-based ingredients. And we probably think that, you know, we will be in a very good position to bring these kind of blended products to market. So the question is, will the world be vegan? I doubt it personally, but will the meat industry look very, very different from now? Very likely, yes. So I think that the big, huge, like scaled production for affordable or let's say cheap meat will probably come from a bioreactor. And then you will probably have kind of artisan, very, very high level premium meat that's still going to come from traditional livestock. That's going to be hopefully very, very different from what the meat or livestock supply chain looks today, which is awful.
I just kind of see, looking at you, Meng, and also you, Cathy, that both of you seem to be nodding. Is it kind of an approach you also see?
Yes. So we also have a cellular agriculture team where we make cultured meat. I definitely do agree with Philippi. And so the problem with livestock meat, I think people just don't realize there are so many problems there. So in the US, the sales of pig pork, so plunged because of the coronavirus. But people don't know is that all the pigs, from the moment they kind of mature, you only have a few couple months window to sell them, actually, to harvest them into meat. After that, they are no longer good, and they don't have any place to move to. So if you don't sell those pigs, the new baby swine, they are growing, and you basically have everything backed up, and they don't know what to do. It's a livestock. So it's creating a huge problem in the supply chain, in the business. So I think that's where also why the traditional food sector is also looking for a change. It's why people are adapting.
I just want to jump in here. Slido question wants to know, do you see the coronavirus situation as a more limitation or an opportunity for sustainability-led startups? I mean, it's not quite on topic, but in a way it is. So I just wanted to feed it in. What's your take on that?
I don't think any of us can call this opportunity. It's a very devastating event that has happened, that has impacted all of our lives across the globe. So I'm very hesitant to say it's an opportunity by itself, but we did see a retail sales increase for our product. And it is, people's habits are shifting. I think this was triggered by the event of coronavirus. But at the same time, we were taking a big hit. Our food service sales are suffering quite a lot. I don't know how do you guys feel on this?
Yeah, Cathy, Philip.
So, I mean, yeah, I also don't think it's, you can call it an opportunity as such. But I do think that it shows, I think the crisis does bring about a certain grade of reflection of people in what is really important, what is essential, what should we really be focusing on. I think that it did show an importance that food systems work on a local and global level. So I do think that there needs to be more focus in looking in production within a country, within a continent, and how self-reliant we can be be it ingredients, be it resources. I think it shows a great importance of making sure that we use resources that we already have available in a meaningful way and make the most out of it in order to be secure in our systems locally.
Thank you, Philip.
I also wouldn't call the crisis itself an opportunity, but definitely now the recovery is definitely an opportunity to not go back to where we were before, but really go into a completely new direction. And that's, to be honest, a lot of what we're pitching now to gastronomers, also in the retail, etc. When people tell us we don't have time for a new product, we need to survive, and then we try to convince them that exactly this is the time to come up with a new product. Now, that's of course on the one hand a sales pitch that we do, but in a way we really mean it, because we can't go back to where we were. We really need to change the way we look at things and the way we operate. And I actually see this recovery as a big opportunity. There was a statistic, 50% of all employees, I don't know, was it Austria or Europe, are rethinking their jobs now after 2 months of home office. Can you imagine? 50%, that's a big number. And that really shows us that people are really starting to ask the right questions. And I think that's it's a great chance.
I'm interested. Now, we have a couple of Slido questions kind of going on very much towards consumer habits. However, I'd like to have a look at the international approach here. And I'd like to see, do you see regional differences, the way habits are changing at different speeds? Are there regions which are more open for change, more advanced, and regions slower to change? Or is it too early to tell?
I think the data is surprising for me. I would imagine if without the data, I would imagine our product will sell better in California, where I am at right now, or in New York City, or in the bigger cities, people are more kind of trendy and adaptive. But it's not necessarily the case. Our best selling, so our product that's been selling the best across the national Whole Foods store is actually the one in the middle of nowhere. The name is not even on top of my head. I can't remember the name of the city, but it's in the middle of nowhere in the United States.
So it's like Bible Belt country.
Yeah, so it's interesting. So I guess we're making innovations. So I guess it's sometimes also good to look at the market with an unbiased view, without all how you're told what you say on the social media. Those might not be representative anymore. The market is changing. Consumers are changing rapidly.
I just wanted to follow up on that. I'm just curious, do you think it's just out of convenience that people are adapting to your product more likely in the middle of nowhere because they have no, let's say, over access to other products?
I wouldn't say so, because right now I don't think we really have a competitor's product like plant-based egg. We're pretty much the only one for like scrambled egg or omelet application. I feel like it's more because of the internet is bringing a lot of new things to remote areas, and people are changing and they don't have access to, they used to not have access to those content or to be influenced by those content. But now because of YouTube, because of Instagram, because of the internet, so a lot of information actually reach everywhere in the world. So you don't know how the consumers are going to think. Their resources are changing.
Thank you. Katia, I was just very curious to follow up on that.
Yeah, I think that's a super interesting point. There's a big architect, Rem Koolhaas. He brought out a piece of like a book on the revival of the countryside, sort of. Like he was the last 30 years, I think, he was all about the cities and all about metropolitan areas. And now he's saying, well, the countryside is really gonna celebrate a revival. We're not going to see this tomorrow. We're probably also not going to see this immediately next year. but we're going to see this trend in the coming years that people use spaces differently. And they have, as Ming mentioned, they have access to the same internet. Usually, you know, they have access to the same kinds of information, even if people live in the countryside. And the countryside is not being used so much for agriculture anymore. We can make agriculture much more efficient, use less space, and use the countryside actually for different things. And that changes consumer habits and the landscape of what we do with our space, our resources, and how we spend money as well, I think.
Thank you. Now, time is flying, but I still also want to hear your opinion, Philip, on that.
We don't have so much experience in our product on international markets. We see that there are some first projects going on in other countries. I just feel like here as Europeans, we actually must be very cautious to not fall back into this now nationalist trap of a lot of different regulations. Because I think that's one of the main advantages in the food innovation space that, for example, the US still has over Europe. You have a much more common regulatory landscape. And I mean, in Asia, the regulatory landscape is just much more liberal. So that's quite a different approach. But I think in Europe, we have to make sure, you know, we're not now falling into this nationalistic trap, and rather have a real strong European Union and make sure innovation can really spread fast. And I think that will be very helpful now from the internationalization perspective.
Thank you for that. Now, it's kind of a panel and a topic. I think we're just getting warmed up because it's so complex and there's so many different aspects to it. However, we're already more or less at the end, and for me, the takeaway is I think it's an incredible time where a lot of change is happening. It's been happening before. And I think what I find is we're just at the beginning of changing the way people actually eat and the way people understand how food can happen. And I think one of the main challenges, if I understand it correctly, is also a lot of habits, cultural habits that are holding us back. People just saying, hey, we've always done that, so it has to be good. But then again, due to the way we're changing and minds and ideas are traveling through time, due to the internet, these are also times where people reflect on habits that have been formed and are open and willing to reform them. On the one hand, because of healthcare, on the other hand, out of economic necessities. What I find really interesting, obviously, is we're not talking about something that's going to happen in the distant future, but we're talking about something that's currently happening. And a lot of people are listening in right now, understanding where areas where a lot can still be shaped and a lot can still be changed. And I think this is a huge, super exciting industry. I'm very curious to be looking out for all three of you to see what's going to happen, to see it the way it's going to change. And I have to admit, it's a field which has been so enjoyable ever since I personally saw the first products in 2015 in the US. I'm super intrigued. And thank you very much for joining in. And all of you out there, just give it a shot. And also question your own habits on this and question why certain things are necessary or not. In that sense, thank you very much for joining in. Stay safe. And now it's time for a short networking. And don't forget, you can have a look around in the exhibition areas. Meet and mingle as you would at an offline conference, because digital is better than offline or something. In that sense, thank you very much for joining. Stay safe, and don't miss the next panel.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Stay safe. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
future would you choose?
Never give up.
Can achieve anything.
Enjoy every minute.
Crack on.
We must help others become game changers themselves.
Creativity is really the main driver.
The game always remains the same.
We become that much better and stronger together.
Yes, we will!
The kind of place where you meet exciting people.
We must strive to be game changers.
The next wave would be you.
Awesome.
You change the game!